Hi, everyone. I'm Cassidy, and I host the Buddhability podcast. I got the chance to sit down with Orlando Bloom for an open conversation about his Buddhist practice. For those who haven't listened before, Buddhability is a show about believing in yourself and changing the world for the better. Each week, I get to speak with Buddhists across the U.S. about the ways Buddhist practice has helped them become wiser, more compassionate, and more courageous. In my talk with Orlando, we use some Buddhist lingo that might not always be clear for a new listener, so I want to break down a few things so that you can easily follow along. We talk about the Gohonzon, which is a mandala or scroll that SGI Nichiren Buddhists chant to. It's a depiction of the life state of Buddhahood within us. That's why the Buddhist teacher Nichiren Daishonin often described the Gohonzon as a mirror. So rather than chanting to something outside ourselves, we chant to the Gohonzon to see the Buddhahood in our lives. If you're curious about the Gohonzon, you can get connected to a local Buddhability community. You'll hear us mention the Buddhist mantra Nam-myoho-renge-kyo, which we chant in the morning and evening. And chanting is a core part of our Buddhist practice. Orlando shares about the Buddhist philosopher Daisaku Ikeda and refers to him as sensei, which affectionately means teacher in Japanese. If you're curious and you want to learn more, we have plenty of articles on Buddhability.org and over 150 podcast episodes. You can also reach out to us to get connected in your local community. I hope you guys enjoy the episode. All right. Thank you so much for joining, Orlando, being a guest on the Buddhability podcast.
Thank you for having me. It's really an honor.
Yeah, it's such a joy to like have you here, and just chatting a little bit before, I felt like, oh, wow, you're just so warm. And, you know, the same sense that I get from anybody that practices this Buddhism, you know, it's just this kind of like, yeah, warmth and sincerity. So I'm really looking forward to a conversation.
Me too.
Yeah. What kind of kid were you growing up? What was your childhood like?
Good question. Yeah, I was a very sort of adventurous child, I would say. Mm. I struggled with learning, like I had a dyslexia, which was diagnosed when I was about maybe 9 or 10. Mm. And so I struggled a little bit in school, but I had a really high IQ. So it was interesting. Frustration was quite challenging for me because, you know, I would understand so much more than I was able to, like, get on the page, as it were.
Yeah.
I actually, like, part of my education, once we deciphered that I was determined that I was dyslexic, was to learn to write cursive and joined up and stuff. And that was something that really helped when it came to, like, writing in school and the speed of thought and executing like that. But basically, I was a sort of really happy, kind of happy-go-lucky, adventurous, loved to ride my bike, loved to kind of be outdoors, quite sporty. I was a bit of a risk taker. I think I took more risks than my mother felt was ever necessary. I was quite accident prone, I would say, but interestingly, from a very early age. So my mom was like, you know, well, I'm not sure, you know, if like, you know, because I was in and out of hospital a few times because I had like head injuries and stuff, because I was like cracking my head, falling off a stool, climbing out of a tree, and crazy stuff. But it was also like, you know, I would say part of my joie de vivre, part of my excitement and enthusiasm for life. And like, I had a sort of inner feeling that like anything was possible, you know, like, and that I could do sort of anything. And that was something that I think over time, and certainly when I met Buddhism, became a little more boundaried. I have famously, historically, or at least discussed this before prior, that I broke many bones in my life, and it was when I broke my back that I think everything sort of shifted, because it was a sort of quite a close call.
Yeah.
And that was a wake up call. And whilst I had been chanting and had the practice, it was something that, like, I think was, you know, whilst it was at that time probably one of the biggest challenges I faced in my life, I think it's probably been one of the greatest benefits in my life.
When you say one of the greatest benefits, somebody listening might be like, what? Like this, you know, almost like a near-death kind of moment. Like, to me, that sounds so Buddhist, but I'd love to hear more.
Yeah, I think that at a young age, to have experienced so much physical pain and the prospect of you know, perhaps not walking, and for a few days, for about 4 days, that was the conversation. And I think that, you know, the wiring in my brain and the way that I was looking at the world, like, immediately shifted. I don't think I ever really believed that would be the case. I was in hospital. I was like, yeah, that's not my life path. I think in my mind. But I think, like, I remember a teacher when I came out of hospital. I had quite a miraculous recovery. I walked out of hospital having been told I'd be in hospital for 6 months after, like, 12 days on crutches after a surgery and stuff. But one of the teachers at my drama school said to me, he said, this will be the making of you, because finally, in the space, as an actor on the stage, in the space, in the room, in the classroom, I was sort of still. I was forced to be still. And because I was wearing a back brace, and in a way, it, like, I think it centered me and my energy. And then, you know, and then in my life, it's been something that, you know, like, I kind of constantly work on, you know, like, taking care of myself physically in order to support my back and not, you know, and not get, you know, not overindulge in things that maybe I could have, you know, and take care of my health and wellness in ways that maybe I wouldn't have. So I look at it as I try to look at it as a bonus. And I think, you know, at such a young age, you know, those experiences, you know, I remember thinking of my life, and I remember speaking to a member about, you know, and I think Sensei maybe wrote about this, about our lives being a tapestry, you know, and in a way, like, the deeper, richer colors come from the experiences that we overcome and the way that we evolve and how we turn that poison of our life into the medicine of our life. So the poison of that situation, turning that into, like, the benefit of, you know, I'm sort of, you know, at this age in my life, I'm sort of, well, I take better care of myself than maybe I would have otherwise. And so yeah, I think that's how I look at it, as a benefit.
I mean, it's so, like I said, like, such a kind of Buddhist way. And of course, you know, non-Buddhists maybe have this kind of mentality as well, but
yeah. But this is Buddhability, so we're going to say it's a Buddhist
way. So
we're
only talking about the Buddhist perspective here. yeah, but I mean that, like, any kind of, like you said, poison, like, something that seemingly is, like, wow, something insurmountable or deeply painful can actually be this sort of, like, fuel for our life to really grow. But I mean, of course, like, speaking about Buddhism, I want to know more about, like, how you encountered Buddhism and what made you say, like, I'm going to do this, because I know you were quite young, and I think if I were to encounter Buddhism, honestly, at that age, I would have been like, I don't know. It seems a little weird, you know?
Yeah, it's a good question. So I was actually confirmed in the Cathedral of Canterbury by the Archbishop of Canterbury at the age of 12. I grew up at a school in Canterbury, and I would go to church in the morning. We would go to chapel in the morning and sing hymns and psalms, and I remember looking at Jesus, and you can't knock Jesus. He was a remarkable philosopher, and I would never do that as a Buddhist. but I would say, I did wonder, you know, about the feeling of, like, the responsibility of him being on a cross and that being somehow mine. And I was, like, conflicted with that feeling. And then, however, when I moved to London at the age of 16, and I sort of left my home. I'd been in boarding school at 11, so I was really sort of out of my home environment at 11, and I moved to London at 16. And at 16, I was living in London, and I didn't have chapel to go to every day. So I wasn't connected to a spiritual kind of dimension in that way. And that was something that I always appreciated, actually. And so I was studying in London, and for my sculpture exam, I had to study. I found out kind of close to the exam, which was quite a big deal, that I had for my sculpture exam, I had a 15-hour oil painting, a 15-hour still life drawing, and a 15-hour, you know, sculpture making kind of class, exam, and also paintings and drawings to back up all of the coursework that I'd done. And I was very good at just sitting in front of a piece of wood, some clay, some wire, and just creating something from my imagination that would work. And with given a, you know, maybe it was the mother and child, or but the drawing piece had, was something that I just didn't think about and do. And, you know, you needed, so my teacher was like, well, you realize, you know, you've got these. And I was like, what? So actually it was my best friend, Mark, who had met an artist in our hometown who he introduced me to, and I would travel down to Folkestone in Kent to meet with him and to learn to paint and draw so that I would be, you know, capable during the exams, etc. And it was David David Miles, who shakabuku me, who was teaching me, and I would hear him in the other room. He would set me up with an easel, and I hear him going, "Nam yoning ego, nam yoning ego," and I'd be like, "What are you doing?" And one day I went in there and I was like, "What are you doing?" And he said, "Well, I'm chanting that you're going to do really well in your exams. You're going to have a really successful life." And I was like, "Well, will it help?" And he goes, "Yeah." I'll go, "Great." So I just got down on my knees with him and I started to chant to his Gohonzon. He explained to me what the Gohonzon was. And he kind of, as an artist, he sort of allowed me to, I would say, embrace that practice. Because I think you make a good point, which is like, at 16, how do you encourage somebody to pick up chanting Buddhism or even look at the philosophy? And then he would slowly, you know, and then over the, you know, he would give me guidance, things, pieces of guidance of senseis, of Daisaku Ikeda's, and it was all made very logistical, logical, practical sense.
Yeah.
You know, in a way that was very accessible. And I was like, wow. And I think actually what really kind of landed it for me is that, in a way, I think the magazine in the UK is called The Art of Living. And I was looking for that, you know. I was looking for a roadmap in life. I was looking for like something like a roadmap, you know, wanting to be an actor, not knowing how to start that. Although I moved to London in the hopes that I would kind of like get into theatre or drama school, and I did join the National Youth Theatre, and I did all the things that like people would do to sort of at that time in my life and in the world, like embark on a career in acting. But I really wanted some kind of like, I guess, philosophical kind of roadmap.
Yeah.
And I think that, you know, it was just very apparent to me almost immediately that like chanting Nam-myoho-renge-kyo and studying the guidance and getting to a place where I could talk about the practice, getting comfortable with that, was the roadmap that felt right for me. And it was, in a sense, this idea that when I chanted to my Gohonzon, as many people to say, we're polishing the mirror of our life, you know. So I'm chanting to my Gohonzon, and I'm revealing to myself the things that I need to consider. And in a way, the idea that this is within me and that it's my responsibility in this lifetime to overcome the obstacles in my life, that was something that was just like an aha moment. You know, I was like, oh wait, I'm not gonna pray to somebody for forgiveness, or, you know, I'm going to realize that the law of cause and effect, which we know is strict and is something that, you know, is in our lives. And I think that idea, by the way, runs very concurrent with any other religious practice.
You know, absolutely.
You reap what you sow, do good, get, you know. So that was an easy kind of handle for me to kind of get hold of. But then I liked the idea that it was my responsibility to be the best I could be, and that I wasn't asking somebody to help me be better. I was taking responsibility to be the best version of myself. So to work on my human revolution, as we talk about the idea of polishing our mirror or evolving our minds and thinking. And at 16, to have words like integrity or wisdom or courage or compassion, just which was basically everyday dialogue for sensei to give out, right? It's like, you know, I mean, I don't think I even considered some of that stuff in some ways, yeah. You know, not to say that the teachings of the Bible that I had learned weren't in some ways, you know, also, you know, accurate in their thinking. But there was just the way that Sensei presented his thinking and the way that, you know, this, you know, practice was made sort of palatable for my young mind. I think each of us has our own path. You know, we were discussing earlier when you were saying that you were born into this practice, and you know, that's amazing. So, and for me, it was like, I really feel like in some way I sort of owned my connection to both Sensei Daisaku Ikeda, to the practice and to the thinking of this practice in a way that was just really authentic and you know, and that worked.
I really love that, like, that you shared you were really looking for like a roadmap or like a framework or like, how do I want to live my life? You know, of course I know that maybe these are my goals, but like, what kind of life, what quality of life, what is the purpose of my life? And I think for so many people, that's what Buddhism like really provides. And
I'd say it's as hard, if not harder today.
Yeah.
You know,
absolutely.
To continue. To stay on point with what's important, not to get, you know, distracted by the distractions or the devilish thinking that can come into our lives.
Yeah, absolutely.
So in a way, it's been an incredible blessing. And I have used my practice and, or at least it has supported my thinking on pretty much everything. And the only, you know, like, yeah, I just, when it's not clear, I chant. And even sometimes that's challenging. And I have some really good Buddhist friends who are like, have you chanted? I'm like,
I love this. So, you know, relatable.
Like, it's like oh that, oh like, god,
oh,
really?
Do I really, yeah,
do
like,
I really, I thought we were, I thought I've gotten to the place.
Yep. Like, I'd rather just like, can I just sit down?
What is that? Like, what is that? Know? What is that thing about the lights over? You don't stop until
the moon over. So it's 12 days the journey, and on the 11th day, if you stop, you'll never see the moon over the capital.
Yeah, and that is key for me right now.
Yeah.
You know, because you know, with so much good fortune in my life, with so many opportunities, you know, and so many, it's like, no, right? You don't stop before you see the moon over the capital.
Yeah.
Because Sensei never stopped, right?
Yeah.
And that's something that like is so interesting. I was thinking before we came together about that, because it's like it's the honest truth, isn't it?
Yeah.
You know, it's like we're always given the opportunity to keep growing.
Every day.
Just get down and do it.
Yeah.
Just do it. Just get it out.
Yeah.
Even if it's hard.
Yeah. I mean, it's definitely a daily practice of like action, you know, taking responsibility always, which sometimes is hard. You know, sometimes it's incredibly joyful, but sometimes it's like, wow, I really have to like do this hard work of like you said, like polishing your life, you know?
Yeah.
And I was just gonna say, like, you know, for folks listening that haven't heard like any of these Buddhist kind of terms before, I just wanted to share like the Gohonzon is like a mandala that we chant to. So all Buddhists that practice this form of Buddhism, SGI Nichiren Buddhism, we have this in our home and we chant to it, but it's not like something that has these kind of magical powers, right? Yeah. But it's got, you know, this inscription on it of Nam-myoho Renge Kyo. It's like a reflection of our lives. So I just wanted to share that for people that are like, what is that word that Orlando is saying?
Thank you for pointing that out. I actually love the ritual aspect of those parts, you know.
Yeah.
It was something that to begin with it was like, oh, so when we chant to our Gohonzon, it's inside our butt sedan, which is a wooden box, mm-hmm. And then, you know, lighting a little bit of incense, having some greenery, some fruit or some flowers, and having like a few words of encouragement in the mm-hmm. form of like, you know, my you know, sensei's books and writings. But it's like, it kind of, it's a nice moment to take pause for self, you know, and yeah. that can be hard, but it's also the opportunity, you know, it's a nice, it's a really nice reinforcing thing to have in the home as well.
Yeah.
I definitely feel it's protection too.
Yeah.
You know, in a way, like, I almost think of it like I've referenced this before, but like it's my superhero cape.
Mm.
Do you know what I mean?
Yeah. Like, yeah.
And I don't want that to sound, you know, insincere, but like in some ways I do find chanting to be yeah. a form of protection.
Yeah.
That is unique to me mm-hmm. as it is to each individual who chants and yet something that is so easy to share mm-hmm. and protect, you know, and I love that about it.
Yeah. I mean, I think like, you know, we do our best to chant every day and yeah, when I chant, like, you know, chanting Nam Myoho Renge Kyo is like tapping into your own enlightenment, your Buddhahood, your Buddhability. And yeah, like when I chant, you know, I might start the morning being like, oh my God, like I have this list of things that like I don't want to do, yeah. or I'm like, I just had a fight with my partner, whatever, yeah. you know, and then I'm chant about it and I'm able to like, you know, really bring out my life force.
Yeah.
I'm like, oh, okay. I can do yeah. this. I can bring wisdom out, you know? Okay, I know how to go back to my partner and yeah. like, you yeah. know?
Isn't it interesting? Because I think in a way, like without that, it can just become this slog. But it's almost like it's going to be challenging,
yeah.
right? And when I chant, I'm engaging the capacity to overcome those, see those obstacles as the opportunity for me to grow.
Yeah.
Just like when I broke my back, it was been an opportunity for me to take care of myself
mm-hmm.
that maybe I wouldn't have done. Who knows? I don't yeah. know. I could have become like, you know, I could have just, you know,
yeah.
overindulged,
yeah,
you know,
totally.
In different things in life and not taking care. So, and I think, yeah, like, you know, it's that I find the greatest opportunity through
yeah.
for chanting, you know.
Absolutely. And I'm wondering, like, timeline, you know, you were, I think, in drama school when you injured your back. And then, like, pretty shortly after, you landed, like, huge career, like,
defining
moment. Like, were you chanting about your career?
Yeah.
Like, and what was that? Like, how were you chanting? What was that experience? I mean, it must have been, like,
yeah.
Pinch
yeah,
me.
Yeah, it was wild. It was a wild pinch me moment. It more than pinch me. It was like bash me across the head. Wait, am I alive? Wait, is
yeah.
my life? Wait, what's going on?
Wow.
I think I was most definitely chanting and very, you know, I think there are waves of practice.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, and certainly when you embark on this practice, you know, and especially if you're blessed to be a young person, then you have this, I certainly had this enthusiasm and discipline and dedication and I would say need for this path and a need for, you know, in my heart, this sense of understanding and almost like a sign, you know, like I think like people say, you know, you can, earthly desires lead to enlightenment, right?
Mm-hmm.
So that idea that you may chant for a car because you need to get to work. Okay, great. But you may chant if you're just starting off because you want to see actual proof,
yeah.
benefit in your life. So it's not some kind of magical wish one,
mm-hmm.
but you can chant. And then, you know, I remember somebody saying, well, you may not get a car, but you may find somebody saying, well, actually, I drive past your house every day. I'll pick you up and then I'll drop
yeah.
you home. So then you're getting a ride to work. You're not paying insurance or tax. There's no response, you know. And it's like,
yeah.
so it can be conspicuous benefit as well as, you know. And so in a way, at my tender age and with the circumstances that I had grown out of, I needed, I think, some kind of, I felt, or at least I had the sincerity of heart to realize things, to realize aspects of my life. And I certainly chanted for everything and I would say indirectly, because in a way I was sort of, I would chant for this like light around the world. Mm. You know, it was like, can I be a light in a way? And it was like, and somebody had, again, one of David's, when David, somebody who David knew had sort of suggested that idea to me, and I was like, oh wow, yeah, okay, I could be a light like that. Anyhow, but also like, yeah, I was auditioning for parts. I was at drama school. I was performing. I was dealing with all of the anxieties and of stage fright of like, can I do this? Am I good enough? Am I capable? Can I retain this dialogue? Am I going to dry on stage? Am I going to forget my lines? Mm-hmm. Am I going to, you know, there were a plethora of things going on, and, you know, and learning lines, you know, is something that now is very accustomed to me and I'm very good at, but I was learning a way to learn in a sense at drama school. Mm-hmm. But I chanted, I chanted, you know, to, I guess we talk about fulfilling our mission for Kozen Rufu. Mm-hmm. And what we mean by that is fulfilling our mission, Kozen Rufu being to create value. So like if I'm creating value, so like if it's meant for me, then I'll have the opportunity to create value, and that would be a good thing. So that was, I think, you know, how, and with the sincerity of my heart, I think that's partly, you know, I mean, I played Legolas, who, you know, is an elf who is like a very like cool, but like, you know, and the elves are like ethereal and they're like, you know, they're immortal, and so much about the elves was like kind of concurrent with almost like a lot of my Buddhist thinking. Yeah. Although I didn't want him to be like, you know, Legolas, I didn't want to be like some kind of like ethereal otherworld. I want him to be like flesh and blood. Like, and I knew that he came from a realm in Mirkwood and that they were kind of like militant elves. So I kind of had this idea of him, which kind of came through. And I was like studying Kurosawa. I was looking at Kurosawa movies, again, a Japanese director. Mm-hmm. And that was because Buddhism, this practice comes from Japan. So there's a lot of swirling things. You know, I was absolutely chanting, you know, to fulfill my mission. And I think that, you know, there's no shadow of a doubt in my mind that you know, it enabled me to navigate that those times in my life. Because, you know, I was 16. I didn't have parents around. I was living in London. Plenty of distractions, plenty of things to get, like, you know, off course with. But in a way, coming back to practice and the discipline of that, I think was something that was, I think, important to me anyway, because I felt I had, like, a big dream and goal.
I mean, definitely, like, I think we often talk about in this Buddhism, like, all of us have, like, a unique purpose for our lives, you know, and when we say Kozen Rufu, meaning like, you know, peace through each individual person's happiness and like fulfillment of their life. And yeah, I often find that like when I can really chant about, you know, whatever kind of goals I have in my life or whatever problems I'm encountering, when I really think about like, how can I like also really contribute, it makes it so much more enjoyable too, you know, like, cause it gives so much more purpose and meaning to like, oh, it's not just like, oh, I landed this, but like, wow, this is really like part of my purpose in my life.
Yeah. And I think that, you know, the fundamental principle of this practice for me that I think is that idea of Kozen Rufu is of value creation, that that if you selfishly do anything, you know, I think, arguably, if you are somebody, I think we, as humans, we feel better when we're doing things for other people.
Absolutely.
You know, when you get the opportunity to do something for somebody else, you know, it feels good, right? Mm-hmm. And so that's just part of this practice that's built in, which is that you're constantly, I used to think, well, if I can take care of my side of the street good enough, well enough, or if I can, you know, then hopefully I'll evolve to a place and practice enough to be able to take care of somebody else's side, because ultimately that's what we're sort of all trying to do, right? Mm-hmm. We're trying to, you know, work as a global, citizens yeah. doing our best, and certainly within the SGI.
Totally. And it makes my life just so much more expansive.
Right.
You know, like I find that when I'm just really absorbed in like whatever's going on in my life, whatever suffering I have, my life is just kind of small. Right.
Yeah.
And then when I can start like, okay, thinking about just the person next to me.
Yeah.
My life feels so much like, oh, wow. Okay. Yeah. You know,
just being
like
curious about somebody else.
Yeah. Yeah. It's amazing how much something just like curiosity about someone can really like create this life to life kind of connection, and even momentarily. Right. But that can shift so much in someone's life, in our own life too.
Yeah. And we talk about the 10 worlds, right?
Yeah.
Because we fluctuate through the 10 worlds.
Yeah.
Moment to moment. So sometimes it's like, no, I'm definitely not in the mood to help somebody else right now. I'm just trying to survive this moment. Mm-hmm. But, you know, but then we kind of, the more that we practice, right, the more that we become capable, and the more that we become, you know, open to the idea of, you know, how do we maintain a curiosity for others and therefore, you know, help others, you know?
Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, that's, you know.
Yeah, I mean, that's also like kind of another way to describe when we talk about human revolution or like transforming our lives is, you know, these 10 worlds are all different life states that we can have in any
fluctuate,
one moment,
yeah.
right? Fluctuate in like one moment I'm joyful, other I'm...
And the 10 worlds being the lowest to the highest.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes, yes, great.
And we live in that... I think like that, you know, the lower worlds are the ones that we can easily inhabit.
Yes.
And then we can get into into like the higher worlds, but I can't even remember how to name the higher worlds because I'm like, but
Buddhahood is the highest.
Buddhahood
that's
is
the most
one
important.
That we're shooting for. That's the goal.
Yeah. 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 Tap into it any moment, right? When we chant, right?
Yeah,
it's bringing out this, But yeah, like you said, like, you know, throughout our lives, as we continue to practice, it gets easier to access sort of those higher life
and
states.
Understand, I think, right?
Yeah,
it's like
totally.
The one thing that years of just continuing to check in with myself through practicing and chanting is that it's like little aha moments all the time. Like,
yes,
that's what that means.
Yeah.
Okay. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And in a way, like, because I have continued, it's like, you know, I think like Buddhahood is, you know, is not going to happen tomorrow necessarily.
Yeah.
It'd be wonderful it could, but like, but it's a lifelong path, right? And, and that's that's the joy, you know, because it's sort of like, that's the opportunity and, you know, and it's the possibility, you know, when you see the obstacles as the opportunities, then you know that you're like starting to kind of get it. You know?
Yes.
You go,
oh my gosh.
This one again.
Yeah.
Okay.
It's amazing when you can have a moment where like you go, oh, almost immediately, oh, this really sucks, but okay. I know that this is opportunity.
Yeah.
And I'm sure you probably didn't always like have that initial like gut reaction, like, oh, okay, this is like, this obstacle is great for me. So like when you then like broke out into, you know, new career and you were young, thrust
a whole heap of other obstacles.
Yeah.
Right,
like thrust into the spotlight. I mean,
that I could never have seen coming or even known how to handle.
So like, where did your Buddhist practice like come into play during that like really just, I imagine, very intense time?
I'd say where didn't it? In a way.
Because
it was like, you know, I think, I know it was an anchor for me. I know that it was very grounding. I know that the practice was an anchor and felt very grounding. I know that when I was in like, in a sense, the eye of the storm of my career at a different, in my life, in my sort of mid to late 20s into my early 30s, it was like, you know, there was so much to knock me off center.
Yeah.
But I kind of just chanted through all of that. and, people having opinions about you and, whilst you're like learning and growing and, not figuring it out and not having a clue and, feeling judged or feeling ridiculed or even dealing with, the idea that you're the second coming and that you're I haven't done anything. I'm just figuring this out. There was the Eight Winds was a really great kind of, piece of guidance that somebody had shared with me. And that was a real kind of a wise man isn't swayed by the eight winds of praise and censure, honor, disgrace, prosperity, decline, pleasure, and suffering. Mm-hmm. I'm not sure if that's the right order, but you mm-hmm. get the point, yeah. right? Which was like, oh, okay. So I want to be a wise man and not be, not be just tossed around by other people's opinions of mm-hmm. me. Now, I'm not saying I wasn't, because I think I was. Yeah. At different times, I was definitely tossed around.
Yeah.
But I think that fortunately, I could keep coming back to these ideas and these principles. And, it felt a little bit like being in a human experiment. And the medicine for any of that kind of like onslaught was always like just chanting. Mm. It is in a weird way the ongoing opportunity for my growth is to keep kind of like, not to get swayed by, prosperity and decline or, whatever, praise and censure. I mean, pleasure and suffering and, all of these, it's like they are in a way, the things that, we can easily kind of get distracted by. I would say there isn't anything that didn't, have an aspect of Daimoku behind it, from, presenting at an award ceremony, I'd be chanting on the way to the ceremony. I was chanted in the morning. I'd be, going to an audition or meeting with a director or, if this is for me, there was sort of Daimoku, especially through that period as well, that was backing up all of that stuff.
Yeah. I mean, I truly can't even fathom that experience. Cause
I can't either. Honestly, it's almost like, of course I remember things, but there is a part of it, which is just like, so much was happening at such a rapid pace that it's almost like I didn't, it's interesting. That leads me to meeting Sensei because I was in Japan. And I was at the Fuji Rocks. I had been asked to go to Fuji Rocks, which is crazy in itself. It's a music festival, but here's me, right? And they were like, we just want you to go out and this environmental global green company organization, I think it was global green or anyway, an environmental. And so we want you to go out and just say, look, the environment rocks kind of thing. So, And I'm like, didn't really have a script. I'm going to go, hey, let's protect the environment. But it was actually while I was there that one of the members here had sort of thought, wait, he's in Japan, Sensei's in Japan, how do we get him together with Sensei? Mm. Like, as if that was something that should happen. That would never have occurred to me. And I think there was some kind of conversation. And I often sort of wonder why that actually happened or why Sensei thought it was a good idea to meet me. Mm-hmm. Like, you know what I mean? In some ways. And I'll never forget meeting him. And first of all, like, I got a phone call saying, okay, you're going to... You could meet Sensei. And I was like, wait, what? Mm. You're going to get picked up from this, from the Fuji Rock Festival. And we're arranging a meeting with Daisaku Ikeda, with Sensei. Mm-hmm. And I was like, I'm not okay. ready for this.
Yeah.
Am I ready for this? No, I mean, what does that even,
Yeah.
So then it was like, and it was sort of amazing. I remember these members, you've probably been to Japan, and I'm sure some other members have been to Japan, but the members in Japan are just like,
Yeah, really incredible.
I mean, they're just like levitating somehow, you know. It's like, it's just like,
yeah,
I've never seen joy like it. You know, yeah. Joy is like, so like, I'm suddenly like, it was like as if I was suddenly taken on this magic carpet and I was taken off on a wave of daimoku. And then I remember, like, I was just like chanting, and and I was talking, and I was being given like those delicious finger sandwiches, and writing, like, what am I going to? I've got to write a poem. I've got to give him something. What am I going to say? What am I going to do? You know, I was one of those.
So, did you know before you got to Japan?
No.
Oh wow!
No.
Quite a big surprise.
No. Yeah. So you know. So then I remember we like got to, you know, we were in these in a minibus heading to the Nagano Training Center, which was where Sensei was studying and working in this beautiful region and center. And I'll never forget, I got off the bus and I literally, I saw Sensei and I was like, it was as if it was like a lightning bolt or something hit my brain. And I was like, oh, I've done this before. Like somehow, like I felt like I knew this person. Like, and I don't mean, and of course I know Sensei.
Yeah.
Because Sensei is in my heart and I've studied and everything else. But it was almost like, wow, I think we've walked lives of this. If there are many lives, this is one of them.
Yes.
And I'm like, and we've done this before somehow. And I'm like, this is, wow, this is wild. I ran over to him and I gave him a massive hug. I was like, and he went, boom, on one side of my cheek, boom, on the other. And then he went, and then he looked at me and he went, and he sort of smiled. And I was like, and then he just like, you know, he sort of looked at me and sort of laughed and smiled and and then it was like a dream. I mean, it was like, he was driving this, I was in this golf car and he was driving this golf car and it felt like we were flying around these little paths in the Nagano Training Center. And I'm like, and we get to this room and there's like, and he goes, and these are the orchids that we put here for you. And they're so beautiful. And the members are all like, it's like, it was like, it was almost like being, you know, in a Disney movie in some way, you know, like I'm trying to like in some kind of like otherworldly existence, you know, of like, is it possible that there's this much
that people
sincerity,
can
joy, consideration, care, attention to detail, thought? The first thing he mentioned was my mother, which was like, because I love my mother. But my mother is the greatest opportunity for my development and growth, you know, historically. And, you know, and it's not because she doesn't love me, she loves me like, you know, like impossibly, but there's, you know, but the process of my upbringing and aspects of it were super like conflicting and challenging in some ways, but also, as we say, the opportunities for my to grow and develop. And he kind of like, so he sort of just like nailed pretty much everything. It was as almost like there was this amazing translator. So of course he's speaking in Japanese, but like it was as if he was speaking English, you know. It was like the translator was just like sublime, like the way that she was like expressing. And then he I remember he gave me that he expressed those thoughts around my mother, which was sort of like it was like, wow. And then I read this poem, which I had written on the bus, and he was sort of like, wait, those sound like my words. And I was like, well, they probably are. I read your guidance every day, and I'm sure it's like, it's an amalgamation of all your thinking, but it's like a version of my. And then we were in this beautiful room to discuss all of these things. And there was somebody explaining who I was and why I was here. And, you know, that I'd been in these movies and that's why, you know, I was in Japan and, you know, and who my friends were and why they were there. And my sister was there as well. Which is great. And so, and then we got back on the golf buggies and we went back out into this like beautiful landscape of the Nagano Training Center and like landed at this other like kind of place where we chanted, where it was like it was a room that was with a beautiful gohonzon set up. And Sensei sort of, I remember he chanted, and I was like, it was so different because it wasn't like he had this amazing rich voice, you know. But it was just like other world, you know. It wasn't like I thought, you know. It was like something else. And but he chanted, and then I remember he gave me an award to give to my mother. He gave me an award for the arts. He, you know, and I think, like, when I think back on it now, what was sort of amazing is that it's so, like, transferable, because long after I'm gone, hopefully for any young member, it can be like, oh, that could have been you. Mm. You know what I mean? Because it's not me. I mean, it is me, but the circumstances could be so different for anyone. But, like, in a way, it's like he was talking to as my mentor, and my mentor, he being as the sensei, was my mentor. He was talking to me as a disciple, as if he would be talking to any of the members of you know, the SGI. And it's sort of like, and I realized like later that's sort of what it was. It was about the members. It was about, you know, it was about a mentor talking to a disciple, and you know, and kind of passing the torch in his own way without, you know, passing the torch. When I saw him on two other occasions in Japan, because I was at meetings that he was at, you know, it was always, you know, the thing that struck me was how important the members were, but mostly how important it was that the members understood their value. That the members understood their importance, that each member understood their value and importance, that there was nobody above them. That the thing that's amazing about this practice is that we have the potential to be Buddhas, and we have the Buddhahood inside of us. And Sensei gave us that. He gave us the you know, this practice is the vehicle for us, right? And the opportunity for us. But we're the ones that are responsible for our lives. And we can use this amazing tool, which is what I sort of almost think of it, to transform our lives on a daily basis, even when we're in hell or the, you know, hanger or, you know, anger or suffering, to kind of like lift ourselves out of that. But it was really, that was something that just really struck me, you know, because he was never, you know, he was never lauding it, you know, he was never like, you know, it was like, he was us, he was the mirror, he was a mirror, just as we should be mirrors, and just as, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Does that make sense?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. I really love to, like, it sounds like, you know, in your encounters with him, like, you felt like just really that he's connecting to you as a person, you know, not like Orlando Bloom, this and that, right? Yeah. But just like who you are as a person.
Yeah.
And I think that kind of like quality is something that, you know, all of us really strive for.
And I think that was apparent because he didn't see himself as above anyone else.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know? Like, you can't really speak to somebody on the level unless you're on the level.
That's,
do you know what I mean?
Absolutely.
Like, and there wasn't a sense that he was, I think he almost didn't like that. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like, if ever.
Yeah.
That was my sense. But.
Yeah. I mean, I think absolutely. Like, we, in this Buddhism and like historically in Buddhism, there's mentorship, right? And mentor is not someone above you, right? Somebody that's actually just showing you this is like the path. This is the way that you can live your life so that you can, you know, how to achieve, you know,
that's
this
right.
kind of happiness. And
thank you for clarifying mentor.
Well, I'm wondering, like, maybe you can share a little bit too, like, I know that you consider Daisaku Ikeda your mentor, and sensei means mentor, like it's kind of term of, like admiration, but not like, you know, above, right? But what has it meant for you to like have a mentor for your life, and why Daisaku Ikeda?
Well, I think I sort of answered it, but in a sense, you know, to have met the practice at such a tender age, and not even that it was a tender age, but an influential time in my life, you know, and looking for that roadmap, and then the simplicity of the guidance that he, you know, would put into the world and what was shared from Japan in whether it was like The Art of Living, the magazine, or, you know, the magazines that we, it was, or the books that you could read. Mm-hmm. It was sort of common sense.
Yeah.
It was sort of almost scientific, because whilst this is a religious practice, of course, you know, as a philosophy, I almost think of it as a bit scientific.
Yeah.
You know, it's really a bit like, well, it's sort of like gravity. What goes up must come down. And and I think that, like, the practicality of it is something that I found so useful.
Yeah.
Because, you know, I can be at home and chant and raise my life condition. Now, if I take that life condition into the world, I can really have an impact on people. Hmm. And then if I take that, you know, into a Buddhist meeting, that is just the foundational aspect of this practice, which is like the members and being a part of that. And of course, the nature of my schedule in life is that I'm everywhere. So finding, you know, myself, you know, in meetings is sometimes harder than I'd like, but just that, it's like, it's almost like, it's like water over a drought, you know. It's like okay, if it's not, you know, you know, it's just the, because it's sort of like only when, you know, you are with other members that you see the things that you can work on, you know, because everybody shares, you know, in a meeting, not everybody, but people will share their experiences and their challenges and their obstacles, and you get something from everyone. If you're curious and interested, which hopefully through the practice we all are, but then you get these little glimpses of like, oh, okay, this is why I'm here. Mm-hmm. Because I can continue to listen to the same book or like study or read and stuff, but if I'm in a void of just self, then it's sort of like it's self-orientated, and then I'm not, you know, I'm not like doing my part. I'm not, you know, because we need to be, we need to be in society. We need to be functioning. We need to have a voice in our communities to have an impact and to have a positive impact. Right. Mm-hmm. And it's something that you can forget about when, you know, we've been through a COVID crisis and we're like, we all just want to be indoors and just like, you know, get lost on our phones or like, I don't know, just avoid people or to actually, but continue to involve yourself and engage the way that Sensei did, you know, like that's certainly one man you can't say didn't do the most.
Yeah. You know? I know this is like kind of a pivot, but I'm really dying to talk about your show.
Oh yeah.
Because when I was watching it, so we can, you know, the pivot is, you know, Sensei Daisaku Ikeda traveled the world, expanded his capacity.
Well, actually,
you did the same.
I will say that when I saw Sensei, I talked about climbing a mountain. I think at the time it was like, I'm going to climb Mount Everest for you kind of thing.
Because
and, you know, I subsequently realized that Mount Everest is not necessarily, you know, I mean, there's a queue on Mount Everest. And, you know, and it's like, if anything, everyone needs to stop climbing Mount Everest.
Yeah.
And probably like clean Mount Everest or, you know, figure out how to do that. But because like what part of my ego was attached to the idea of climbing Mount Everest, right? As opposed to like, you know, as opposed to the sincerity of my heart. And I was in COVID when I was really challenged. And I think we can all agree that COVID was a very challenging time for everyone on the planet. Mm-hmm. By the fear that I was surrounded by and was feeling impalpable, you know. Mm. And I don't like fear. I don't think that fear serves me. I don't think that fear helps me to, you know, overcome things. So I was like, And I remember at the time I'd just started, you know, working with a couple of people on developing projects. And I had this thought, I was like, well, if I come out of this, what am I going to do that's like really going to challenge me to overcome my fear? And actually, initially, what I wanted to do was like talk about blue zones and maybe highlighting the idea of what it meant for certain people to live long and prosper kind of thing, right? You know, and there are many communities around the world, but it turns out there's already a blue zone trial. And honestly, nobody, you know, I was like, could I meet other Buddhists in different parts of the world and talk about what they, but like, nobody wanted to finance that. It was like, But like, we will throw you out of a plane and see if you can swim to the bottom of the ocean and or climb this peak. And I was like, okay. Well, I mean, I did say I was going to climb something to sensei, and and this would be over. I mean, so the show is about me overcoming my fears, is about me becoming capable, is about me using my practice. And I thought long and hard about how I would chant on the show, you know, because I was like, I don't want to seem trite. I don't want to, you know, I don't want to turn people off, you know, because I respect that other people have a different, you know, practice in their lives or way of doing things. So I was very conscious of like how to broach that. And I really kind of got a lot of guidance from people about whether or not, you know, and how the authenticity of how that would land. But I do chant in the show because the practice, you know, because chanting is a big part, obviously a huge part of my life, and also something that does help me to overcome my fears. So, but yeah, I basically learned to skydive and then in 25 jumps, which is pretty attainable for anyone. I did it on a very short trajectory. But what's maybe not so attainable and something that's been done is I learned to wingsuit after that. And the wingsuiting aspect is really challenging. Really, it's I was working with Luke Aikens, who's like an amazing he's the guy. He's the head of the like Skydiving Federation and stuff. So he had a series of checklists that if I passed those, I was like, good to go, continue. Mm-hmm. So I was right in it. So I was definitely like, you know, I was switched on and doing it. So that was huge. And then the free diving was huge and proposed all of its own challenges. And I swam to like 37 meters, which is like 102 feet on one breath. And that was pretty big, quite a big achievement in like, you know, the space of 7 days or whatever. But I'd been working on my breath prior to that, and then I climbed, you know, which was wonderful to climb while sensei was alive, this peak in Moab and stand, and I stood, you know, on this pinnacle at the top of this in
so
Moab
scary.
And I was like nom, 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 you know, for sensei, and it was like terrifying. I mean, it was like possibly, you know, physically and, you know, mentally and emotionally, one of the most challenging aspects of the show in some ways. They all post their own little torture devices on my brain. But it was, so that was, you know, and that was something that, you know, I'm, you know, it wasn't, you know, I hadn't planned to do an unscripted show or documentary. I hadn't, you know, but I think that, like, you know, I'm really glad that I did it. I'm glad that, you know, I think that the way that, you know, the practice is sort of broached and touched upon is not too heavy handed, and it doesn't, you know, it's not banging anyone over the head, which is really important to me because I don't want that. It's lovely to be able to talk about Buddhism on Buddhability because obviously, you know, the audience is set for that, and, you know, it's great. But, you know, I think we all do recognize that we're talking to people of the time, right? Mm-hmm. Like sensei always in guidance would say, you need to talk to people at the of the times, you know, recognize the times that we're living through. And so it's like, you know, having the wisdom to do that correctly was something that was important. But, you know, the show was, you know, I did see it as an opportunity to sort of, in a way, you know, shakabuku, or, you know, for create, you know, have some curiosity for people, and if people are interested, you know, and you know, and it's nice to be able to talk about it in that sense.
Yeah, I mean, honestly, like, I am somebody that's like really not a risk taker at all.
Risk adverse.
Yeah, I am very risk averse. And so, like, when I saw the promotions for it, I was like, I don't know, but he's chanting, so I'm gonna check it out. And I have to say, like, honestly, I was really struck by like how vulnerable of a show, like it felt very intimate. And I like, honestly, even going into this interview, I felt like, oh, I already kind of like, I have a sense, you know, of who he is and kind of like, yeah, his sincerity, his heart. And so much of it, I feel like, in a way shows, of course, it's in the setting of like, you know, really pushing kind of adventure limits, but you know, in our daily life, we have all kinds of limitations, and it seemed like I don't know, like a perfect illustration, honestly, of like what it's like to engage in this Buddhist practice when you're facing challenges. I really, really loved it, honestly.
Thank you for that.
Yeah, yeah, of course, of course.
I think it's, thank you. That really that means so much to me. I think the thing that I really hoped was that, because of course I'm me and I'm not whoever's watching the show, and whoever's watching the show, like you, might be completely risk averse. But what is the version of confronting your fear?
Exactly.
Like it could be like, I'm going to make Sunday roast for my family and friends. That would terrify me probably more than jumping out of a plane, quite frankly. Or you know what I mean? Like, yeah. Or it could be like, I'm going to learn to public speak, or I'm going to learn to, you know, I don't know, but I know that through COVID we were all challenged and like even for some people just getting out of the house into society. So I hoped and I hope through the show that people would watch it, would get that, because it's not, it's really not, you know, it's really not about me doing wild and crazy things. And, and I think there was like, you know, I think, you know, if you don't have like the vision for that, then that's perhaps, or if you're very fear adverse, then you might like take that the wrong way. But it wasn't, I wasn't taking unnecessary risks. And I think the thing that I learned was about becoming capable, because I think there's this term about like adrenaline junkies. And I think actually everybody that I met that taught me, they were supreme athletes. And they were about as far from an adrenaline junkie as I could get. Like they had an appetite for stepping out of their comfort zone. They had an appetite for pushing their edge and going past what some people would think is reasonable or capable, you know, a good idea. But they were doing it in incredibly measured, incredibly well thought out, detailed ways. Way more than somebody else. I mean, that I've ever come across. Do you know what I'm saying?
Yeah,
so in a way it was like, for me, the takeaway was also about becoming a capable person, like learning something so well that I could be capable enough to do it and, or at least push my limit or take it to that limit. And that was something that like, you know, you can't take away from me. So you can say what you like about the show, and it's not, you know, if you're a mother of like, if you're a middle-aged woman with a mother with like three kids or two kids or even one child, and you're like, I don't want them to watch this and be like getting any ideas that Orlando Bloom thinks this is a good idea, then you're missing the point. You know, because this is not like, you know, try this at home. No, it's the opposite. It's like, it's like, what's your edge? Push your edge. Don't, you know, like for me, I'm a little bit unhinged. So jumping out of a plane in a wingsuit was a good idea.
That's your edge.
But you know, it could easily have been learning to cook. Or public speaking in a way that, you know, I hadn't thought about, or stand-up comedy. I mean, I don't know. There's a ton of things. But I think that, you know, like, or going to a meeting. Let's take it back to Buddhability. You know what I mean? Like, let's not be afraid to go to a meeting. Let's not be afraid to mix, you know, let's do what it need, do what you need to, like, you know, take care of your health. You know, Sensei was always like, he I remember him talking about my health a lot. And, you know, the members were always taking care of, like, you know, making sure that everybody felt safe and so on. But I think, you know, if you bring it back to your daily life, then what is it? It's like going to a meeting, you know, stepping out of that comfort zone, get out from behind your computer or your phone or your whatever it is, and go into, you know, into, you know, the meetings, or, you know, make that effort. And there's always something to get from it, right? And that's the gift, you know. It's sort of crazy. It's like that we have this as members, that we have the opportunity to mix with strangers sometimes, but who have this philosophy. Like, you, how can you not learn something?
It's
unless you're just like just been living in hell for a long time, and in which case you're still gonna learn something. You know, so it's like, it's just a win-win. It's a win-win.
I mean, was just recently chanting about, like, I just want to, like, expand my capacity, you know? And of course, when right. you do that, then you're meeting the edge, right? Like,
and you're asking for it.
Yes.
You're going to ask for it.
I knew, like, okay, I want to be even more, like, capable, even more joyful in my life. And so, of course, you're bumping up against the fear, right?
Yeah, and I think the other thing is, like, what are you waiting for, right? Like, I think that what I realized, and there's that analogy of, like, when you're chanting, you're like, somebody gave me this, and you have to forgive me because I got plenty of analogies.
No, it's
there,
great.
Right? But
it's
they've all come from the right source, I promise you. I can't tell you which one, but
A source,
and it was definitely connected to this practice and the SGI and Buddhism. But, you know, it's this idea of, like, a glass of tea, you know, in Japan, and you would stir the leaves, right? And the leaves, through stirring, would come to the surface, and through chanting you're scooping them off the surface. My thing is, it's like, that's such a beautiful analogy for life, because if you don't, then the tea just sours and it's too strong and it's gonna, you know, and over the course of your life it's just gonna build up all this sediment. So you want to keep stirring it, you want to keep chanting to scoop it off, because otherwise when you're in your 60s or whatever age you like, it doesn't have to be in your 60s, in fact it could be just at any time in your life, it's going to clap you, right? It's going to be like, wait, and you're not prepared. Whereas if you're just constantly doing it, then you're sort of constantly preparing. And almost constantly preparing for the fact that, you know, okay, we're going to leave this body. And then, you know, and that's something that I think is really challenging for people, the fear of death, or the idea that we won't ever be, we're not here for, you know, it isn't a life thing, a lifelong, I mean, it is a lifelong, but it isn't, but I believe through my practice that it is eternal, you know, and that, you know, that's the thing that I think, you know, is so reassuring as well, you know, because if you're constantly avoiding the idea of death or not thinking, you know, but like just because you chant Nam Myoho Renge Kyo, you're sort of aware that that's part of this path, right? I think that's something that I find super encouraging as well, you know, it's like, because I'm not going to be suddenly surprised that, like, I've gotten sick, you know, oh yeah, well, I'm about the right age, I'm going to get sick around about now, what am I going to do? I'm going to chant through that, and then I'm going to overcome that, and then maybe I'll probably drop this body, but hopefully not before I'm time, and you know, but it's like I'm chanting for that, and I'm protected through my chanting for that, you know what I'm saying?
I had just like one more question that I wanted to ask you about, like, of course, we're having this, like, great dialogue now, but I, in the show, I found, like, you really engaged with, like, the experts you were working with so, like, life to life, you know? Like, I felt like the kind of relationships you were building with them was definitely palpable, and in the first episode, the wingsuiting one, you have this like sit down conversation and the reality of death is like very present. You know, you're talking about like, I think his father had passed away. Like, I'm curious, like, what made you have that conversation, and, you know, did your Buddhist practice like inform any part of that dialogue or those kind of interactions with people?
I think that as somebody who is curious about other people, and especially somebody who, you know, has been handpicked to teach me something that is about essentially taking my own life in my own hands in a very physical, meaningful way that, you know, is very real. You know, I think, you know, I was fascinated about, you know, he is the same guy, by the way, who jumped from like 25,000 feet without a parachute, right? So like, which by the way, turns out is again, something that like with real expertise and methodical practice and his certain set of skills is not something that's unattainable. It's just something that's really like mind blowing. But actually when he taught me through what was necessary, I was like, oh, I see. It's like, it is a stunt, but it's also very methodical and accurate. So I just was curious about, you know, just, I think it was, you know, I'm just interested in people. And I think that, you know, if we're practicing correctly, and sometimes again, we're not, sometimes we're surviving life and sometimes we're thriving in life, but like, you know, when we're thriving and connected, then yeah, I mean, I'm always interested in who, you know, the what, who, where, and how of it all. Because I think, you know, seek first to understand, then to be understood, right? Like that idea of like, well, what's making him tick? How, why is he doing this? And how does that, so that's, I think a lot of where, you know, that came from. And I think it was a really important part of the show because in a way it was like also something that like, you know, just showed that, you know, he's a vulnerable and real, you know, because he's somebody who's like, about as, you know, like that gung-ho masculine and daredevil kind of thing is, but he's also this teddy bear with like a real, you know, like we all are, like we can all present how we like, but actually, you know, we're all getting up in the morning and figuring out how to get through the day and what we're going to do to survive this one and, you know, how we're going to navigate the relationship with the partner or the child or the mother or the whoever, the father or the, you know, or the boss or the friend or the, you know, and it's just like, you know, in a way it's like just by chanting your, you know, it's like pouring more love on it. And it's like having gratitude for it and going, okay, give me the wisdom to deal with this. Give me the courage and the confidence to articulate it. And you know, and I think like we're supposed to make mistakes, right? Like that's like, I think in my youth, I was so visible. I was so terrified of making mistakes and actually like, we don't really learn if we don't make mistakes. And You know, I mean, I'm definitely learning all the time. You know, I'm not, you know, I think the one thing that like, you know, I've learned like from the show and everything else is that, you know, it, you know, you're not going to avoid making mistakes. You know, so if you have a challenge, if that's a challenge for you, then you got to get over it because you're going to make mistakes. And you know, with a philosophy, you can have the wisdom to overcome the mistakes, right? You can have the wisdom and the courage, but like you can't avoid that. You know what I mean? You sort of can't avoid it, just like you can't avoid death in a sense. Do you know what I mean? It's like it's like if you're trying to be perfect. Then you're on the wrong path.
Yeah,
100%. Because like that's not what this is about. You know what I mean? Like it's about making mistakes and then figuring out and getting up, right?
Yeah.
That's what I'm. That's my realization of. Like, you know what I mean? Like because, you know, my son will tell you I make mistakes.
Yeah, I was.
My partner will tell you I make mistakes. You know, my mom will tell. I mean, anyone can tell you. You know, and if I in my head think, well, I'm not. I'm Buddhist. I'm not making mistakes. Then I'm wrong.
Yeah.
You know, and that's my ego because no, I'm fully, you know, I'm definitely evolving on this one, you know, so, and that's, but I am so grateful to have Nam-myoho Renge-kyo to take me through that and to give me the wisdom to overcome the obstacles of, you know, whatever that mistake may be, you know, or because that's the thing, you know, and, you know, as time goes by, you know, you kind of, the mistakes are maybe a, I don't know, actually. I was going to say that they get less, but I don't think that's true. I don't think that's true. I think you just get better at dealing with them, right?
Yeah.
Less hard on yourself, perhaps.
Yeah, so I'm wondering, like, in terms of, like, being a father especially, like, how does Buddhism inform being a parent? Like, you mentioned being okay with making mistakes.
I wish it informed it more sometimes.
It's a process. We're learning.
Oh, my God. I really do. Like, I've had some like rip roaring arguments with my son that I'm like, wait, am I 13 too? No, I'm not 13. What's going on? Yeah. Why am I so triggered? So, but I think create value. Nam-myoho Renge-kyo. Create value. Like, and sometimes it's going to be hard to do that. And sometimes they're not going to see that, but I'm going to keep chanting to create value. And if I keep doing that for everyone involved, then hopefully that will be the winning ticket. And I'll make damn sure that I make it the winning ticket. Not always, you know, not, you can't, influence other people necessarily. I mean, mm-hmm. you can try, but you can't really. You can only show up. So that's... Mm. And like I said, sometimes I'm like, wait, what?
Yeah.
I've been chanting since I'm 16 and now I'm 13 as I stand before my son and...
Yeah, yeah.
But... you know.
Yeah, I mean, relationships are like...
Yeah.
They're a reflection of every part of ourselves.
It's all this amazing opportunity for us to learn and grow. Like, I've been crossing my hands. I'm like, but the truth is... there isn't a truth. It's just yeah. keep doing it. You know,
yeah,
I think
yeah.
if you just keep showing up,
hmm.
You know, it's showing up, right? But
hmm.
in terms of like in front of your gahons and or chanting, you know, studying more
hmm.
and just getting to meetings.
Mm-hmm.
You know, like we've got the tools with this practice.
Yes. But do we use it?
So, like, honestly, like, I was looking for a roadmap. This is the roadmap.
Yeah.
Unquestionably.
Yeah.
Now, do I want to get in my own way sometimes?
Yeah.
Ugh. Do I ever self-sabotage? Like, you know, almost sometimes I'm like, you know, if I'm not chanting, I'm like, I know I'm just sabotaging myself.
Ugh.
Or if I'm not studying, I'm like, I know I'm just creating obstacles for myself.
Ugh.
Why are I doing this? Like you're not like there aren't enough.
Oh, but, I don't want to hear this. But yes, you're right.
But it's like so we have the tools.
Yeah.
With this practice, you know, and you just and we've seen Sensei achieve it
mm-hmm.
in our lifetime. That's phenomenal. If you've been a member, you know, if you've been a member since before Sensei passed, then you know, and even if you haven't, to be honest, it doesn't matter because all of the writings in this lifetime,
yeah.
we have this remarkable, you know, mm. mentor, and we have the teaching, we have the practice, we have the strategy of the Lotus Sutra. You know, you just gotta like get on with it, one
yeah.
foot in front of the other, and sometimes that's what it is. You know,
yeah.
it's like I'm not like. At this time in my life, I'm not like, it isn't beyond me to realize that it's like just getting one foot in front of the other sometimes,
yeah.
you know?
Yeah.
But I think when I tap into my Buddha nature, when I sit in front of my gahons and chant, when I show up to a meeting, when I study,
yeah.
my blood pressure goes down.
Yeah.
I remember that there's something way more important than the trivia that I might be navigating in this moment.
Yeah.
And that none of these things can come with me.
Hmm.
And that none of the stuff that I think I'm accumulating, the treasure of the storehouse,
yep.
can go anywhere.
Hmm.
But, you know, just through chanting, you get the wisdom, right?
Yeah, yeah.
You get the, just through chanting, when you are, you know, reflecting those things. And that's really hard sometimes,
yeah.
right? Depending
yeah.
on the individual. And for me, certainly at times, I'm like, oh, God, do I really have to look at this right now?
Yeah. Do I really have to see the reality
of can I not
like...
just go back to my iPhone
or yeah.
whatever? I mean, I'm actually not a big person for that. But in some ways,
yeah.
I am. But,
yeah.
you know, I mean, can I not just go back to, like, ignorance?
Yeah.
You know, because ignorance is bliss. You
yep.
know, can I just, you know, bury my head again?
I mean, I think sometimes when I chant, like, I've heard many people say this to me, like, it feels like you're kind of, like, returning to yourself, you know, like, your most authentic part of you, your true nature, really seeing, like, you know, the value of your life. And
yeah,
it's so easy, like, in my day-to-day life to really, like, lose that.
Sight of that.
Yeah, but when I chant, it's like, oh, there she is. Okay, great. And so, yeah, I want to kind of conclude maybe just with a piece of advice.
Give it.
Well, you've already given me all kinds of advice, but this is for, you know, folks listening that are like kind of curious about Buddhism. They're listening and they think like,
yeah.
oh, this might be for me, but they're not totally sure if they want to like really test it out, try chanting.
Right.
What would you say to them?
I would say there's nothing to lose and everything to gain, you know, like just try it. I mean, you know, like what have you got to lose? What have you got to lose? And I do think, you know, you test it.
Yeah.
So I do think that if there is something that is a challenge in your life that you seem to be unable to overcome in the way that you're living your life or thinking about the challenge, I think you can create that, you can take that as the earthly desire that you wish to transform, and you've got nothing to lose by trying. You know, you chant, and if it's not for you, if it doesn't impact that situation, maybe find another situation. Like, some people might have some impossible situation, but maybe if you're capable, if it's not, like, as I said, you may not get the car if you're chanting for a car, but you may get a ride to work. And that may be something that you hadn't considered. Or you need to, it's conspicuous benefit as well as the opposite.
Inconspicuous.
So I think there's no harm in, you know, I think there's nothing to lose and everything to gain. And as somebody that, you know, has really put this practice through its paces and is still doing that. And like, if there is an art to living, then I think this is it. I think this practice is the art to living, and it gives us a tool and a philosophy and a discipline that, like, I think we need now more than ever. You know, I think that the distractions of, you know, whether it be the internet, social media, the onset of, like, what is AI going to do to us? I think the discipline for mental health and the benefit of chanting and the discipline of just, you know, the practice, the really basic things of, like, you know, faith, chant, study, read a book, learn about it, and then, you know, share it, being able to share it in meetings and so on. Those are fundamental things for humanity, for human beings. Like, and as we go through life now with this new age of, I mean, my daughter's not going to know a world without super intelligence. You know, she's four. She's not going to know a world without super intelligence. My son didn't know a world. I didn't. I had a mobile phone when I was 20, but I didn't, you know, like, the internet is super intelligence, the algorithms that, so like, this as a practice is just very tangible. It's very, and that, I think, you know, if you want the message, if you want something as a bedrock of just, you know, that, then I think that that's what this practice offers.
Thank you so much, Orlando. This is like, honestly, I feel like such an honor that I get to have this dialogue with you.
It's me too. Really, thank you. Are you kidding me?
Oh, no, no, no.
Yeah, so good.
Yeah, I mean, just thank you so much for being just like really so sincere and authentic. And I felt kind of like nervous going into this. How's it going to go? But like immediately I felt so at ease. And I just really appreciate all of your time and just sharing so much.
Trust me. Thank you for coming all the way from New York. I really appreciate it. It's awesome.
Please. This is great for
me. That's great. Well, I hope I'll look forward to seeing you again. We'll have to check in another time.
Yes, we'll do, down the road update.
So how did that go?
Oh,